Hello guys, and welcome to our Kylo Ren starter set unboxing for the game Star Wars Destiny.
We're here.
It's a super exciting time for a lot of reasons. One, it's finally jacket weather again.
I know.
It's serious.
We had a little, there was like a scare of like back to heat.
Yeah, summer's hard for tabletop gaming, ultimately. I mean, it's like, nobody wants to do anything in summer. You just want to sit around.
It's hard for all activity.
It's hard for everything. Yeah. So we're back to reasonable temperatures and reasonable weather, which means it's nice to sit back, go in, play some games. You know, it's a kind of a family time, isn't it? It's a bit
sure.
more of a get together and enjoy
that
yourself.
Winter's coming, which means the new Star Wars movie's coming.
Oh man.
But also it means that Star Wars Destiny is coming.
That's important, yeah. So this is Star Wars Destiny, the collectible game from Fantasy Flight. And we're gonna take a look at actually the box. We're going to unbox it in a
this
real
box.
Way. A lot of people over the years have said, your unboxings, you don't actually unbox anything.
You need to show the cards.
And we've defended that for a long time. But this time we're actually going to, because this is actually somewhat of an unknown product at this point.
We're gonna sort of unbox it.
We're gonna sort of
we're
unbox it.
We're not gonna touch this. It's gonna stay there.
This is the box now. If you actually have this, whenever you buy it, it's gonna have three dice up front. So that little like cavern is not gonna be
this,
there.
There's this area here.
There's
featured
some dice
right,
going on.
Direct and center.
But more importantly, let's move this into a shot of some kind here. So we've got cards up top. We got the dice in here. I'm gonna remove these, Zach, and then I'm gonna hand this off to you. So see, this is why we don't unbox. It gets kind of fiddly.
Yeah. So the box came like this. Cards go here. They're wrapped in the back here. You had the rules and the cardboard sheet with the tokens and whatnot.
We popped them out for
and
you.
And yeah, of course. Well, and for use. And then the dice are in here. So it's nice. Actually, I'm gonna pull this open. It's a nice little tray.
It actually holds, and I actually like this a lot. So as you collect cards, and not all cards have dice associated, just the special ones, but you can store them right there. So even right out of the gate, you're gonna get two of these if you buy both the starter sets, and you're gonna have plenty of storage for your decks and your dice and all that. So that's really handy.
Yeah, each can hold 18, which is both starters, or 18 dice of your choice, which will be more than plenty for a deck.
All right, well, we did it. We unboxed it.
Done.
Exciting.
Now we unboxed it. Wait, we should, next time we'll punch tokens out.
There you go. I've seen a lot of videos that actually do that.
Yeah.
So let's talk about these tokens. We got some threes. We got some ones.
Looks like damage.
And yeah,
damage.
They are damage tokens. How many ways have we skinned the cat on that one? Then we also have resources in the form of these little crates here. You see those there. And then we also have shields.
Which
in the form of these helmets.
In the form of
I'm not hating on this because
Jango Boba helmet.
You know, obviously this is not the most obvious shield token.
It is at least armor of some.
It's very
kind.
Star Wars, and it kind of shows a defensive kind of thing. So that's why that.
What's funny
is
to me
made,
is
sure.
Outside that being the shield icon, is that you have this iconic helmet, right?
Yeah.
That's that, and then resources are just a box.
This is a box.
And then damages are just.
You know why?
You know,
it's because, you know, there's other companies out there that might take a crack at these tokens and make them happen.
That would be interesting, wouldn't it? Anyways, these are the cardboard tokens that come in the box. Or get those. That's per starter, so that's...
You'll have so many tokens.
I mean... It's really too many.
We didn't even use all of these during our games,
a two-player game, using a starter's worth of tokens, yeah. You get plenty. So
no worries there.
No frets.
Well, let's dive right in here, Zach. You guys follow along. We're going to talk about the cards.
Where are we going?
We know a lot of people watching these, especially early, if this was like a year past the posting date, you're going to know how to play Destiny probably. But early on, there's a lot of kind of uncertainty about what Destiny actually is. And we should also talk about those dice, by the way. Those dice.
Oh, yeah.
There's no stickers on the dice.
Yeah, hold on.
I thought that when I first saw the preview, I was like, oh, no, it's dice with stickers. These are like heat-pressed, sand-blasted, tumbled. These things are in the die. Like,
yeah,
I can't
like,
feel a...
That art is like...
I can't feel a thing.
And it's like in, and then it's covered in like a nice...
It's like I'm rubbing a genie lamp here, and I can't feel anything.
Three wishes.
So it makes sense. I don't know how... I think they're going to wear very well.
Yeah, I mean, we've used these quite a bit.
It's literally in there. I got to tell you guys, it's in there.
Yeah, and I will say, as if you pick up a normal, like a D6 or whatever, these are actually pretty weighty, like you can hear.
Yeah, they're...
They have some weight to them, and that was a big concern. Actually, like the first time you saw the article, it's like, man, those are gigantic and colorful. They're going to be in the way, and then they're really just not.
They're pretty good.
They fit in with the game. They're colored like the templates of the cards, and
we were impressed.
Works out.
Let's get them out of here. All right. So moving on. You want to get these tokens out of here too? Let's get them out of there. All right, we don't need those.
Tokens be gone.
Let's not distract
apply
you guys.
Apply
directly to game state. All right, let's kick it off. First thing that we've got is an action card.
Not Kylo.
This is not Kylo. We're going to kick it off with a boring but appropriate action card. The first thing you can do is play a card from your hand. So this is standard card game maneuver here.
Yeah, and this very fundamental of the game, you go back and forth taking single actions. No side actions, no, it's just literally I take an action, you take an action.
Yeah, it makes sense. Like chess or checkers or anything else.
100%.
What we
so these are the list of actions you can do, right?
So the first thing, you can play a card from your hand, or you can activate a character or support, and we'll show you kind of what that looks like. You can resolve your dice. And so this is if you have a symbol across any number of dice, you can resolve that symbol and do it all one at a time.
Yep.
You can also discard a card to reroll your dice, which you will be doing. And that's any number of dice. You can pick them up and reroll them. All
any
you have to do is discard, that's right, from your hand. You can use a card action. So there are some cards that have literally an action on them, and it says, do this thing, and that's an action there. And then you can also claim the battlefield, one of the coolest mechanics in this game. Check out Zach's Destiny article if you haven't. It's called I Didn't Want It to Be My Destiny, and that's a true story. We really weren't sold on this one from the very beginning, but then we got a chance to play it and play it and play it, and then we were sold. So Zach wrote an article about that journey, and you should check that out, talking a lot about this mechanic, claiming the battlefield being a cool part of this game. You can basically check out of the current turn to guarantee that you go first next turn and get a little side benefit.
Usually
a lot of cat's paw politics going on around this one, too. Well, it's very intense.
Again, I love that mechanic. It ties into tempo, right?
It's like
there's some usually powerful ability that you can get by checking out a round, so it kind of incentivizes you to not just pass until your opponent
It's almost a little holdover from Conquest. Like that planet claiming ability. Yeah. I like to see how these things start to work their way into all the LCG designs and now collectible design as well. All right, so there's the actions. We also have on the back, we have the dice symbols. So it will actually show us what all the symbols are, what they mean.
Those are important.
Very, very easy. Yeah. And you can keep this next to you during your first couple of games, and it'll make things way easier.
And then it all clicks.
And now we should move on to the real juice of the pack. Let's start with Kylo Ren. And he is Vader's disciple, as we should know by now. He's got 11 health, which you can see up here on the right side of the card. You see his dice faces being displayed on the left side of the card. So if you see a card with this six kind of diagram, that means it has a dice associated.
Sure.
And for the first few games of my Destiny career, I was sitting there the entire time going, trying to see what my options were.
It was funny when you were like, oh, that's the die on the card.
To decide if I should reroll or not. And then you can just look at the card itself and it'll tell you. So that's very important. And we've actually gotten in the habit now of not touching the dice. Because as you start looking, you forget what face it was on, and then you have to have that weird conversation with your opponent.
Yeah, well, it's like, Tim, I'm pretty sure that wasn't on two shields.
He's like, no, it was.
Pretty sure.
It totally was.
I thought it was two resources.
He's a character, of course, Kylo, and this is where your traits are going to go. Pretty standard card game tech there, but that might trigger off some things. So it says, choose a character. This is where you'll find that information. And then a little bit of bookkeeping before we get to the real juice here. We have 10 out of 13 in the bottom left. And that is basically the deck building. When you bring Kylo in as a hero, or in this case, a villain for your deck, you can bring him in for one die, which is 10 points, or you can have two dice, which is 13. And I gotta tell you, dice are so important.
It's a dice game.
It's very hard to not go to the two dice version, but sometimes, let's say, like if you drop him down to one die, you can get an extra stormtrooper the way the points work out.
Sure.
So this is your point cost, 30 points at the start of the game. You bring your heroes and villains in with that amount, and he will take 10 at the very least.
At the least. And it's important to know you start the game with your heroes or villains, your main characters in play, and that's the only thing with point cost.
And
the rest of the deck don't have point costs, and you get 30 points, so.
And once they're gone, they're gone.
Wisely.
Yeah. All right, we also have villain, blue. And villain, of course, there's heroes, villains, and neutrals. And then you have blue, and this basically denotes the type of card that it is. There's like, blue is like force-using cards.
Forcey.
Red, I believe, is military or tactical cards. So these are basically like the generals and the stormtroopers. And then you have yellow, and that's
like
smugglers
scum,
and spies.
All the outer rim.
The outer rim people.
Shenanigans. And it's important to note on the color, so deck building restrictions. To run blue card, you have to have a blue hero or villain starting in play.
Yes.
So that's actually
very important.
And then further, the cards are divided into hero, villain, and neutral cards. And so to run villain cards, you have to be playing villains. To run hero, you have to run hero. But then there's neutral. So like with the blue force users, you might have a force choke that is a villain force user card, so only they can use it. But you also might have force throw, which is a neutral force user, so light and dark side can use it.
Very cool way to do this.
Very cool.
We also have LFL and FG, of course, the old trademarks down there. Mm-hmm. The artist, Darren Tannen, and we should take a second to really talk about the fact that the art in this game is phenomenal. Whenever I first was hearing that it's going to be this kind of like, you know, realistic art style, that can go very wrong. What can also go wrong, is like movie stills. That can look really cheap and kind of weird.
Been there.
So we've gone kind of to what was a risky maneuver, I feel like. Art that has to represent what you expect to see in the actual movies. And it works.
Without just being the same thing as a photo,
and it works.
Right? It needs to be seem animated, but at the same time seem like the real thing.
It's beautiful. So they've done a great job here. And then finally, we have the number on the bottom right. And now, important to note there, a lot of these cards are gray because they're denoting starter set cards, and that's where you find these cards. Other ones will have different colors that denote rarity. So like common, uncommon, rare, and legendary.
Yep.
That's the breakdown. And those are going to be the cards generally in the packs. There's going to be some rares and things in these starter decks as well. But whenever you open your pack, you're going to get one card with, I believe, a die in with it,
yeah,
right?
So basically you get three commons, which I think is blue, a green, or a, yeah, it's green. Not green. What's the other color?
There's like green, blue,
yellow. Yeah. Yellow is uncommon. You get one of those, then you get either a rare or legendary that comes with the die that goes with it.
Welcome to collectible games.
Yeah, only those, only rares and legendaries have dice. So they're, I think legendaries are like purple.
Yeah, legendaries are purple.
Yeah,
so. Which is great, because everyone who's ever collected anything knows that purples is what you want.
That's,
you gotta get the, you gotta get those purples. You gotta get
the purples. Give me some perps.
All right, and then finally, to Kylo Ren itself, another one.
We made
all
it.
The bookkeeping
At
out
last.
Of the way. He's got one melee damage, two melee damage for a resource, one shield, one resource, one special icon. I also call it the Force icon because it's got that
what's
nice
it,
lightsaber on it. It's
card.
A special.
Is this called special?
Yes, it is called special. You can use a card ability.
That's special.
I call it Force because, you know, we like to be
I'm
special.
Gonna, I'm going to just start saying that. That's so fancy.
And then we've got a blank. Kylo Ren has a blank.
And blankskies.
Check out also, while you're here, check out the interview we did with Lucas Litzinger. He talked about why there's a blank on almost every card. Very, very insightful.
All the dicey cards. Yeah.
And then his special ability, so whenever you roll this dice, if you want to resolve his special dice, choose an opponent's character, then look at a random card in that opponent's hand and deal damage to that character equal to the cost of the card you just looked at. All right, let's start getting really juiced up for this, because we gotta get our evaluation pants on. We haven't...
Hold on.
Had this opportunity in a while. You know, it's quite different. When you're on the you know, the 80th Lord of the Rings pack or whatever, we have a feel for the game. We know what's going on. It's, you know, you're introducing kind of new and different concepts, but it's not like this is a new game and we've got new things and we don't even know where to begin.
With Lord of the Rings, right, or any other game we've unboxed, you have a basis for comparison.
Yes.
But Kylo Ren's like, what does 11 health mean?
We're trying to find the basis right now. And so this is an ability, I gotta tell you, so the highest card that I've seen in the game cost-wise is a 5 cost.
Yep.
And I presume they could even go higher.
That's
and so
crazy.
If you pull, I mean, and the highest that I've seen on a dice is 3 damage.
Yeah.
I think it's 3 damage.
Yeah.
So if I use Kylo's ability and I happen to pull the highest cost card in the game, surely that's a conditional statement, 5 damage onto the board, that is the most possible from what I understand.
Currently possible
from a single action,
yeah.
Single die. So Kylo has a huge explosive potential. However, in my decks, I'm usually finding myself running zeros, ones, and 2 cost cards with maybe the occasional 3. So it's gonna even out to about the normal damage you would find on a die.
Now,
but it has the potential to spike or to be really bad.
And I'll go to where I always go when we have these
Zach, tell me, is it about what the ability does, not what it is actually doing?
Yes, what it does without having to do it, which is the moment you, because you can have 2 Kylo dice pretty cheap.
Easy.
Comparatively,
his
cost is 13 for 2 dice is really strong. But once you roll that special, your opponent now has to
play
ask
my high cost.
Some questions, right? It's like even a 3-cost lightsaber, which is incredible, get to that. It's all of a sudden, if you're going to play it, it now makes sense to play it at the moment. Or if you do have a 5-cost, immediately you're like,
uh-oh,
I may need to discard this to re-roll so that I can't get hit with it. Because 5 damage is...
That's a lot.
Kylo has 11 health. That's half health.
And to give you an idea, Stormtrooper's coming in at 7. So that's almost one Stormtrooper down.
Basically, just clock a Stormtrooper.
Yeah. And this is really important, especially because you can resolve this twice. Like, if you have 2 dice, you can resolve it twice in a row. And if you're moving on, like, a resource denial strategy, this allows you to run your opponent out of resources, discard their resources. They can't get the big cards out of their hands, and now Kylo can come through and sweep through and
do a
lot of damage.
Yeah, and at that point, they're, like, just discarding the big cards, which is also fine, right?
Yeah.
So
really interesting and really flavorful too. It just feels very Kylo. I'm not sure why, because it's kind of wishy-washy. It can go big or it can go low.
And it's the whole like mind thing, right? Like he messes with people's
that's
brains.
True. Yeah,
and
yeah.
So like he's looking into your hand and like
and that,
using that to damage you kind of a thing.
I guess that's
cool.
The final thing to say is that it also gives you some information. So you know what cards are coming down the pipe.
100%.
And really just one
I think Kylo, just final rundown there because he's the main character of this deck. he's a very cost-effective character for 10 or 13 points. The dice that you get, he has no bad side. Like, a lot of dice are like plus. It'll be like plus two damage.
Yeah, he can do it all himself.
He can do it all by himself without having to have other dice. That's really important. His ability is good. I think he's just a really solid character.
Very good character.
Great first starter.
Kyla, all right,
so the other character.
Let's get to the vanilla cake of the pack, if you would.
Hey, this will be there's a lot of vanilla that goes into a lot of recipes. You know what I mean?
It's true. Yeah, I've salted almost everything in my entire life.
That's right. The other character you get is the First Order Stormtrooper. He has 7 health. He's 7 points.
They're kind of the salt and pepper of the Star Wars universe, aren't they?
They are.
White and black.
They got salt and pepper
everywhere.
They just make everything a little more flavorful. So 7 points here, right? So he's effectively 70% as costly as Kylo over there. He gets 7 health, so that's, again, going down. His die is pretty bad. Can be bad. We'll talk about that in a second. So he's got 2 blanks, like a Stormtrooper. Nothing is so precise as an Imperial Stormtrooper. Luckily, this is the First Order, so they're slightly more precise. He has a 1 damage, a 2 damage, a 2 damage that costs a resource, and a resource, which I like. No special ability. He's literally just a 7 cheap 7 cost red character. Gives you access to all the reds cards to put in your deck.
That's important.
What I do like is that none of their dice are plus. So if you see like plus 2 damage on a die side, to resolve that, you have to resolve it with a non-plus die of the same icon. And so they're nice. Like that's actually a lot of damage. And you can have a couple Stormtroopers out, and it's like...
That's the thing. Like, I've had a couple Stormtroopers out and just rolled 2 damage, 2 damage. And that's 4
there.
Right there.
Yeah.
Right?
Invaders are like...
Uh-oh. Yeah, so they do some work. They're kind of the perfect balance, as you would expect from a Stormtrooper. They're fairly cheap. They get you access, and this is the most important thing to remember. These guys get you access to red cards in your deck.
For 7 points.
So you put 7 points in at your starting roster, and now I can include all the red cards, and there's some really important red cards that, you know, decks are going to want to include.
Sure.
Stormtrooper gets you access and also can put out some damage and soak it up with 7 health.
And has
a really good balance.
As far as early game, having the ability to roll those resources and kind of get churning is important.
Yeah, so, really serious.
I think Stormtrooper is just a classic.
It's perfect.
He's going to fit. You're going to have 7 points left, right? Or you're going to want red cards, and it's like, this is the... Because you can run like the 2 die Kylo, right? 13.
Yep.
Stormtrooper 7, so now you're 20. You still have 10 points.
You got 10 points, and that could be another bomb character. Love it.
Thumbs up on the Stormtrooper.
All right, let's go to the Frozen Wastes.
It is the battlefield.
Now, this is a battlefield. So this is a battlefield that you are going to be forced to run, basically, if you only have the starter deck. It's the only battlefield you have. It's called the Frozen Wastes on Starkiller Base. And the ability that you get if you take the action to claim this battlefield, aside from going first next round, you get to remove a character die. So imagine this scenario, right? So you did an action, your opponent does an action, and they roll something great on there. Maybe they roll 2 dice, one of them is excellent, like a force ability, special ability. You can say, so I have a choice. I can either resolve my last dice that's remaining, maybe do 1 damage, 2 damage.
Been here.
Or I can take the battlefield, get the claim ability, remove their good die,
and
go first next turn.
Yeah.
And that's really important. There's also cards that trigger off of you having the battlefield. So next turn, since you're still claiming it, you can use those cards now to do some really powerful effects. And this is just a great little battlefield. I think it's going to be in the game for a very long time. Very strong ability. And I guess the downside of this is that there's no real benefit that you're going to be able to reap that your opponent isn't.
Sure.
So some battlefields is like, I'm playing into a discard theme, or I'm playing into a shields theme. Everybody's going to want to take this battlefield. So when you tee it up, everybody's going to want it.
A clarification is a character die is specifically a die that goes
literally
with the character. So it's not like a gun that you attach to a Stormtrooper. It's the Stormtrooper's die. And so I think in a deck where maybe your character dice get spent faster, right, or early,
Truly.
It's like you have some kind of ability or whatever you're doing, or you're playing a bunch of supports that have dice so that you can go with your character and still have actions with your supports.
Yeah.
That could be very powerful.
And I could see this in a really solid rush deck where you're able to push the tempo really hard, but then you find yourself kind of like losing your guys a little too quick because you're rushing and you're not being shielded and all of that. So you can just kind of stop that immediately. It also kind of makes both people in the game want to spend those character dice sooner.
Yeah, and that's
the
really
cool,
right?
Trick.
If you had like, a bunch of Stormtroopers, your character dice aren't like that crazy or important.
It's
kind of divided, right? It's a very different strategy. And the other guy is like a decked out Vader.
Yeah.
And it's
like, take that away.
You roll your Vader die and it's a big damage. And it's like, you're going to spend it.
Yeah.
Like I have 3 damage sitting here. I'm going to spend it now instead of like being able to hold it. And it's good.
Don't discount the battlefields.
Very
important.
Super important.
Very, very important.
Yeah. All right. First event.
All right. These are blue events now. So these are force related, generally villain cards that we're looking at right now, right?
Yeah, I'll specify when it's not villain. We have some neutrals coming down the pipe.
Yeah, we do.
All right, so first up, we have Enrage. It's a zero-cost event. It is villain. It is blue. It has Kylo getting angry on
given to the dark side, basically.
Yeah, and just so we're aware, I mean, this is a talked-about movie moment where people are like, why is he punching himself and making himself bleed? But in case you're unaware...
a reasonable question to
ask you. Yeah, I just want to specify because I see the art here and it made me think about it. There's this whole, like, you power up with rage and, like, pain and anger, like, fuel them and hate and all that. And, like, he's just... The more pain he does to himself, the more powerful he's going to be.
I thought he was doing that Matthew McConaughey Wolf of Wall Street thing. You know, I thought he was just getting himself in.
You haven't seen
it, I know,
it,
it's
Zach?
On my list. I have a long list of movies to see. I'm sorry. Anyway, so he's basically inflicting massive pain on himself because that is how they operate. Like, and it's, anyways. Well. Enrage, event, let's see what it does. Deal a damage to one of your blue characters to gain a resource.
Flavor. All right. Yeah.
It tastes so good.
It's really good. So we've been able to play some test games with these starter decks for a while. Yeah, we played a lot of games. And this is one of those cards that seems just perennially good. It is a very solid include. One resource in this game is a lot, okay? So when you see one, you start with four, and you get two every turn.
No, you start with two.
You start with two?
You start with two.
I've been starting with four.
Are you kidding me?
No, I'm just kidding.
I was like, no wonder I've been losing.
Yeah, so you start with two, and you get two every round. That's insane.
And like, so
that's half of your resources.
On like an opening turn, right? It's like the ability, if you go second, the second player gets to put two shields on their characters, right?
Yes.
So immediately, first off, if you have shields or if you start with shields, I'll do a damage to myself, take a shield off, gain a resource. Crazy. Crazy good. But going from two to three is actually critical.
That opens up a lot of cards. Yeah. There's a lot of that you'll notice as you play that 2-3 threshold is significant, right? Because obviously you start the turn, you got your two resources. I have to find a way to get more. I can roll dice. Yeah. If I don't hit the resources there, do I have any options? And luckily the cards do give us some options to get more resources, Enrage being one of them.
And it's very flavorful.
It's so flavorful. Speaking of, Zach, Disturbance in the Force. This is a one-cost blue event. It is neutral. So both sides can have cause a disturbance.
Cause a disturbance, yeah.
Reroll all dice.
But I thought you could discard and reroll anyway.
First thing, this art is phenomenal. I cannot stress how great the art team from FFG has done on this one, and the artists themselves. The style looks the same. It just gets me amped. I'm an experienced guy. So when I come into this game and start to see these cards on the table, it brings me right into the universe.
I mean, that art is something you want to actually see on a playmat.
Absolutely. Especially this art, because it's extra beautiful.
That's what I'm saying. That's actually like a nice, like, that's a great moment of...
Look at Tarkin. Yeah. All right, so reroll all dice. So why is this important? Let's talk. First of all, it's not reroll all of your dice. So that's when I first saw it, I was like, who cares? Reroll all dice. So every die on the table, your opponent's and yours, gets rerolled. This can be extremely significant, okay?
Yeah.
And what more do you say? I mean, that's about.
The two ways I think this is really significant to me is if you don't have active dice at all, they have two or three and they've been discarding to reroll, and then all of a sudden it's like you force them to reroll, that can just totally screw up their plans, especially late in a turn. Also, if you have the side benefit of having some dice out there that you don't want, that are like on blanks or on things you don't want. This is for one. It's
critical. This is money changing. Money changing. This is a money card.
Money.
Game changing. Money changing.
Yeah, that's a good card.
Get that one in the temple.
All right. Next up, we have a villain event called Intimidate with the one and only Darth Maul on it, which gets me excited.
Where do you land on Darth Maul ultimately? He gets a bad rap because he was it was an association of the prequels that a lot of people weren't fans of. But what do you think about him?
Well,
ultimately?
About Darth Maul, the thing is, he is in the Clone Wars and Rebels.
Ah, yes.
Where they basically rescued the prequels, or at least made it worthwhile.
It was a daring escape.
And we don't need to go into the prequel. A daring escape is clever. We don't need to go into the prequel conversation, but the prequels have a lot of things in them that are awesome.
Yeah.
Right? Like, if we get an Obi-Wan Kenobi that's like Ian McGregor inspired, like young Kenobi, I'd be totally happy with that.
Obi-Wan Kenobi?
We know Padme's in the opening set. That's cool. But Darth Maul is one of the coolest. I remember before the movie came out, it was like...
He's very much a villain.
It's so cool. It's just, and it's a double slide. It's like,
and
oh,
see,
it's
here's
so cool.
What here's what we get to look forward to in Destiny. And forgive us for belaboring the point on this unboxing, but Zach and I are ultimately, like, honestly excited. Like, we really first got into the tabletop scene, yeah. and really, honestly, the trajectory of our entire lives, I would say. Why we're here now, why Covenant started. In fact, Team Covenant came from the name of the team that we put together to play the Star Wars trading card game.
That's right.
So this is a collectible game that we just got obsessed with Star Wars. We had already seen all the movies, but this game got us just jacked on Star Wars.
And it was coming out around the time of the prequels.
Yes.
Side note.
And we're kind of get to explore that space again and get excited about what's the Darth Maul character card going to be? What's it going to do? What's it going to look like? What's the Nexu card going to do? Like, all of these old Star Wars things, you know, are you going to get vehicles that you can start with? Is Luke's X-Wing going to be a starting card at some point? You just start to get to, like, think about your favorite stuff, and it gets to be reimagined yet again in game form. So it's just super exciting.
Yeah, so anyways, I land on the side of put all the coolest things from Star Wars in a game.
That makes sense.
Darth Maul's cool. To me.
So what does it even do?
Zero cost intimidate, remove all shields from a character.
Okay. So let's see, on average, I mean, normal game have 3 shields max.
At cap, yeah.
And then there are maybe 1 card or 2 that gives them an additional shield.
That I've seen, yeah.
And then maybe there's cards in the future that you could even get more shields. I doubt that they'll go down that road, but
I have 20 shields.
At its absolute best, it's doing 4 damage. At its worst, it's doing 0, which is a lot of the time.
It's pretty bad.
A lot of the time.
Yeah, I mean, so shields are a thing. I think there will be a shield strategy. Mm-hmm. Actually, there's a lot of Jedi-ish cards that are shieldy, which makes sense, and non-aggression, discard your deck kind of thing.
Yeah.
This is very suspect to me.
It does one thing only, and that thing isn't always needed.
Yep.
Right? So can we just say that?
If there are answers to shields that also do something else, spoiler, there is.
There are.
I think those will get run way more than this. Because if you're there are a lot of decks I've played that just don't have shields.
And my problem with this is, you know what else considers shields is damage. Which is on every die almost in the game. So,
like, if you could choose this or a card that does 2 damage.
Yeah, oh,
right? It's like
easy.
You're going to choose the 2 damage because it always will do 2 damage. And if you need to remove the shields, you can.
So it's very suspect, but potentially a hedge against future decks that are going to be just ridiculous with shields could be an easy answer to that. But I wish I had an ambush, honestly.
Yeah. Cool art, though.
All right, so let's move on. So let's move on to Use the Force. This is an event, a blue event. It is 1 cost, it's neutral, it's a fantastic scene that's happening.
I think that's Kyle.
And it says, spot a blue character to turn a die to any side. So again, there's a couple of things to note here. Spot a blue character means you have to have a blue character on your board as one of your starting roster, generally. So you spot the blue character, you can do stuff. Now, why that's important is, if there's decks that come along, and we've kind of picked up on this, spot a red character to do a thing, spot a blue character to do a thing. These are generally more powerful abilities because the condition is attached.
Yep.
Therefore, my primary objective becomes, can I get the blue character off the board so that these cards are now dead in my opponent's hand? Same thing with red, yellow, whatever.
Yep.
So run this understanding that if you're using just like a Padawan or something to get this blue card in your deck, they could be off the table first turn, second turn.
Quickly.
And now this card doesn't work.
If you're running any blue, like, the difference between a Padawan and like Luke is a couple health,
yeah. It's true. So be aware that these cards are more risky than they originally appear to be.
Sure. And, you know, early on you might build like mono decks, right? A single color, which is not risky at all because if you're in the game, you can use the card. But the further you get along, right, the more you start
to explore the rainbow.
And it's like, oh, you have Kylo as your only blue character, and then your opponent knows that and knows that they don't want you to play the blue cards. And maybe you don't have any blue cards, actually. That's the trick here.
The spot of blue character
cards. The bigger
cards.
This card pool gets, but it's a balance between, like, because you can run all 3 colors,
yes,
right? Cards from all 3. But then it's like, oh, your Stormtrooper died. You can't use the red anymore.
No spotter red character cards anymore.
That's cool.
You can use the normal red cards, but you can't use the spotter red character cards.
Yeah, that's just a cool balance.
And then, of course, so it's basically 1 cost. Put a die to any side. Now, this is your opponent's dice or yours. That's what makes this really good. If it was just yours, not that significant. But being able to toss one of your opponent's dice to something they don't need. I've been in so many situations. You have 1 range damage, a +2 range damage, +2 range damage.
And you flip the 1.
And what does Zach do? He flips the 1 to a blank. I have 3 dead dice now. I have to either re-roll or just move on to the next turn because I didn't get to use them. So dice control in this game, very important. You're probably going to want to have at least a few slots dedicated to changing the odds in your favor.
You can't have them have those big turns. So it's funny, like I've run that card a lot in my Vader deck, and I forgot that I could change my own dice with it.
Yeah.
There was actually a game where it was like, I almost lost because I was like sitting on the card that could turn Vader's die to 3 damage and win me the game.
Yeah.
But I only had been using it to change their dice. So
It tells you what kind of person you are.
Well, yeah. Control.
Always looking to affect your opponent. All right, so moving on, Zach, what do
we
got?
All right, we got Immobilize, which is a blue upgrade. It's an ability, 2 cost. It's a villain card, and I already said it's blue. You have, what is the resource smash called?
What is that, discard, crack, disrupt. Smash, disrupt? Yes, it's called Disrupt.
All right, so it has 1 disrupt. It has 2 sides with 1 shield on it, a side with 2 shields on it,
Ooh.
A side with a resource, a blank. It can only go on blue characters, which makes sense. This is a force user learned ability for the villains. And it has an action, which is...
Oh, say it ain't so.
It's Bugatti.
Hold on, we gotta, hold on. Let me get the Bugatti train out. Make sure that I'm sitting down for this ability. It actually is very significant.
Action. Remove this die to turn a die to a side showing a blank.
So good. It's so good. So it gives me nightmares.
The thing is, this die is effectively never blank for you. Once you roll it into your pool, you can always remove it to turn one of your opponent's dice to a blank. That is powerful.
It's so powerful. This ability on the board, you don't have to, you see, I would think like, oh, well, maybe it has a couple of special sides on it, and the special ability is you can remove it, resolve that special ability, remove a die.
I know.
You can always use this. It is extremely strong.
Far better.
And it plays into Kylo's strategy. It has some discarding of resources on it. It has some shields to keep your guys around longer.
And just being able to change their dice to not get resources or not get whatever it is they need.
You can just immobilize.
Yeah, and again,
it's so strong.
Talking about a cost curve here, 2 cost.
Yeah.
So you can always play this. Turn 1, you can play this. Turn 2, turn whatever.
I love
first
this
action,
card.
Play this card, and then your opponent has some problems. And like, you know, Vader, as an example, he was on the preview video. It's like, he's expensive.
Yeah.
His die is powerful, but he's expensive. And it's like, you come up against Immobilize.
Yeah.
If you only have 1 Vader die, you're not getting it.
It's tough.
Like, good luck.
Immobilize really just puts you in a tough spot.
Yeah, great card. Great card.
All right, so let's talk about lightsabers, shall we? Boom. This is a 3 cost. Now, this is an important break point. 3 cost, it's an upgrade and a weapon. It has, of course, the 6 sides on it, 3 melee damage for 1 resource. So a lot of damage, but you've got to pay for it.
As a punch.
+2 melee damage modification there. It's got 1 shield, 1 resource, 1 special symbol, and a blank. It also has a redeploy ability. Mm. We'll talk about that in a second, but that's after its character is defeated, you can move the card. And then it has deal 2 unblockable damage to a character with its special ability. So a very solid. Essentially, this has 2 damage, 3 damage, +2 damage, and then a shield and a resource.
Yeah, it's a very super well-rounded die, and I think redeploy is the real ticket here.
I mean, if you're looking for, like, you know, as we talked about, the vanilla ice cream of Star Wars, you have the Stormtrooper is the cake, the lightsaber is the ice cream for sure. And
Stormtrooper lightsabers.
It's a neutral card. It comes in the starter, so it's got that grade down there. Redeploy cannot be dismissed, as I wanted to very early when I was evaluating cards. I thought, Zach, why would I ever choose a strategy? Why would I ever value a card highly if it's all about me losing, essentially?
Yeah. I'm not going to plan on losing.
I don't want to plan on my characters being gone.
But the trick of that is they die.
They die. It happens quickly and without mercy.
Yeah.
They die a lot. The action is moving very fast. So this is a hedge, essentially, against your characters being focus fired.
Yeah.
You put this on a character that maybe is not that significant, but you keep it around, and so now that lightsaber can stay and do some work, or you put on a really powerful character, now you don't want to focus fire that guy until the end,
and
that gives them more time to do stuff. So,
and like, you know, being 3 cost, it's expensive. The ability to move it to a different character when that character goes away, you put this on Luke or Vader or anything, it's expensive. It also isn't blue character only, so anyone can pick it up, you can move it to anybody. Super good. And one thing I want to note about the upgrades is that when you play an upgrade, you can always discard an upgrade that's already attached to get that discount. So if you had Immobilize, you could technically discard it to make the lightsaber cost you 1.
Only cost 1. Zach and I missed this for a long time in our games, and it changed things dramatically as far as valuing these and actually getting them on the table. So don't miss
makes
that
crazy.
Point. You might play a 1 cost first turn, discard it to get a 2 cost into play for 1 next turn, discard that to get a 3 cost next turn. Now, of course, there's a card cost associated with that, but as you kind of see your moments to attach new things and roll those dice, it really makes it easier.
Yeah, anyways, lightsaber, it's a good card.
It's perfectly,
we're going to keep seeing it.
It's just in the right place.
It's right
down
the
right place. Yeah,
it's perfectly usable. All right, next up, we have Mind Probe. It is a 4 cost.
Get neutral. One of those mind erasing kits.
Neutral, again.
I've got an idea.
4 cost neutral. It's neutral, which I didn't actually think, like, realize for a while.
That is neutral, isn't it?
It's a very darkish ability.
Wow.
I
don't see Obi-Wan doing a mind probe.
I don't know, man. They
maybe that's
tricks,
what the
right?
trick is.
That's a mind
maybe
trick.
It's just a minor probe.
It is.
You have to probe it to trick
right?
it. I mean, if I know anything.
Whoa. Mind probe. Upgrade ability. Blue character only. It has 3 damage for a resource. 2 disrupt, which is strong. two discard, which is bonkers.
Very strong.
Yeah. It has two special sides. I love that it's called special. That's going to get
special,
me.
Special, yeah. It's call very it force. Special.
Four sides. It has two four sides. Let's
we'll start
a revolution. And there's a blank. The special ability is deal an opponent's character one damage for each card in that opponent's hand.
And that's two, there's two of those on that die. There's two of those sides
and
on the die.
So, okay, the worst side is the blank, obviously. Yeah. But second to the blank.
Okay, what are those mind erasing kits?
I don't think there is a worse side, right? It's damage for every card in their hand, two discard, two disrupt, or three damage?
Well, see, here's why this card is very, very, very good to me. And by the way, I've listened to a lot of news lately. I'm kind of following the election very closely. I'm so sick of people saying interesting. You and I have tried to get that out of the dialect
that's been on
around
the
here.
Chopping block
but it's
right
like,
here.
Tell me why it's interesting. Don't just tell me it's interesting. Why is it interesting? I'm going to tell you why. It has a kind of dual purpose die here. So you can either be discarding cards. To discard is supreme control. Or you can be using the ability to do damage based on cards in hand. So for instance, I have Mind Probe out. Let's say my opponent freaks out, as they sometimes do.
Because they could do five if they have five.
And it's like, all right, I've got to play this card, I've got to discard this card, because I don't want Mind Probe special to hit. So you just leave it, you don't even roll the dice yet, you just leave it there. And so if they go that route, if they're discarding all these cards, now you try to hit them with a two discard and their hand's empty. If they hold their cards, now you roll the die and you can do 3 to 4 damage based on the Mind Probe ability if you get the special
symbol. Which is crazy.
It's really, really good. And then going with all of that, you have the two resource crack, or the, what is it called, disrupt.
Yeah.
The two resource disrupt that is going to not allow your opponent to play their cards, which then allows you to come back through and perhaps get that special ability later on down the line, or, you know, because sometimes you'll save up five resources.
You got that card.
And now it's like, oh, now I can't, I've got to spend them, yada, yada. So it gets very interesting.
I think this card's really good.
Just
and
set it, interesting.
It's so interesting.
We got to just get so it out. Why is it interesting?
I don't know, you tell me.
Okay, so, what are those mind erasing kits?
This is a really powerful card, and the ability to discard upgrades to put it into play makes it even more powerful.
Yes.
Late game, just dropping this in for two or one, and then all of a sudden, I mean, that could just be a lot of damage.
Very creepy artwork.
And again, once you get down to the end of the game, which happens, right? 30 card decks, you will get to the end of your deck a lot.
I think every time we've gotten to the end of
almost
the decks.
Almost every game, it's like you're down to either your hand and no deck, and that's what's happening. But at that point, you can't just discard cards.
Yes.
Right? So then this thing becomes insane.
It becomes a win condition.
Yeah, it's like, you have four cards in your hand. Do you want to discard one to make it only three damage?
In late game Mind Probe, and I like that, you can potentially hold this for a few turns, wait to get to the late game, discard a two cost upgrade, play it in for two, and then all of a sudden, maybe you have a win condition all like right now. I'm holding
100%.
One card.
And that's why, you know, some of the upgrades will be more usable up front. Mm-hmm. And then being able to discard those for cards like Mind Probe.
It's perfect.
Thumbs straight up.
All right, finally we got the last of the blue cards. It is a blue support. We've got two of these in the deck. It is
powerful.
Called Power of the Dark Side. It is a support, so this just goes on the board and you can use its action as you would any other action.
That art.
Exhaust this support. It is villain, by the way. Exhaust this support to reroll one of your dice, as you might expect. Power of the Dark Side. Usable by everyone. It doesn't make much sense, does it? Exhaust this support to reroll one of your dice, any die. If that die rolls a blank, deal 2 unblockable damage to a character. Oh my goodness.
All right, so
I love it.
This is incredible for every reason. First, it's some of the best Vader art you've ever seen.
It is, and look at it.
It's so good.
It is, and
that's,
look at
that's
it.
That's what was on that
kind
play
of a
mat
prerequisite
from Worlds last year for the LCG. Anyways, it's a reroll that you get to keep using every turn forever. If you roll the worst side on your die, which is blank, you get tube damage, which is...
It's fantastic.
And you still have the die.
Unblockable.
To like reroll with something else and go again.
Right through
unblockable,
shields.
Right through the shields. And if not, it's like you get a good side.
It's just
on
a reroll.
Die. And like at the end of the game, this support is like...
It's very serious.
Again, once you get down to no deck, you... Discarding cards is not really an option. This is great.
You know what I've noticed in Destiny? It's hard to play long game cards. It really is. Because it's so fast and it's happening and you want to get your one cost and one cost and I got to stay up. I got to get the tempo going. But if you actually get this on the board and use it over the course of 3 to 4 to 5 turns, you start to really understand that, hey, I'm winning more games. And it's like, oh, because of this.
Yeah.
I'm playing longer term effect cards. And imagine this with Immobilize, right? So I roll Immobilize. Let's say I get an effect. I don't write... quite like it. I re-roll it to a blank.
I do two damage,
and then
now
I remove it.
The next turn. It's really good. This card is actually, it's right where it needs to be. It two cost is correct. It's very playable, very good. And the better your dice are on your characters, I think the more you'll see this, or like the more specific result you're trying to get.
Yeah.
Right? if you're playing a discard deck, or if you have a Vader die that has a 3 on it and you're really trying to pound in the damage.
And these also are very good for stopping essentially the claim war that's going on. So you can delay, reroll a die, yada, yada, yada. Your opponent claims the battlefield because they have nothing else to do, and then you can unload with like 6 actions.
Yes.
Really, really for strong. Sure. All right, Zach, take us to the red cards.
The red cards, we have a red upgrade. It's a weapon. It is a 2-cost F1 1D rifle. It's a villain. It has a 2 damage for a resource, a +1 damage, a +2 damage, a resource, and a special side, as well as a blank, of course. And it has redeploy, again.
Killer.
The magical keyword.
The old stormtrooper rifle, just getting.
The special is force an opponent to deal 2 damage to their characters, distributing the damage as they wish.
As they wish, however they want. So not quite as strong as dealing 2 directly to something, but you're getting your damage on the board, and that's the way you win, so you have to do X amount of damage.
It's
over
very stormtroopery, right?
It's very
like, just shoot anywhere, hope you hit, and it's like, do the damage somewhere, you get a pick.
And they do the old, like, flea flicker kind of thing, you know? As one stormtrooper goes down, they can toss the rifle to somebody
else.
Yeah,
just keep passing it on. Or just it's on the ground, you pick it up. But the thing is,
less exciting.
3 of the dice are range damage, so you have a +1, a +2, and a +1. And with a stormtrooper and with a lot of these things, having another die that could be 2 damage, like there are turns where it's like you have this, another gun on a stormtrooper, and you roll, and it's like there's 6 damage showing.
You just blow it up. And this is a dice with 4 damage sides on it, basically, because the special is doing 2 as well.
So this is a great weapon. Redeploy, I can't sing the praises of enough.
It's cool.
Because it's good.
All right, well, let's move on to the best defense. This is a 1-cost event, and it is deal 1 of your red character's 3 damage to remove up to 2 of an opponent's dice. Okay.
So I dismissed this card at first.
Did you?
Yeah, I was like, this is bad. 3 damage is so many.
I mean, I probably did too.
It's so many damage.
I wasn't happy about it.
But then you convinced me.
But then what happened? Okay, villain. It's a villain card. I convinced Zach by saying the following. There's a couple of important things to note. One, let's say my stormtrooper or other, I mean, we say stormtrooper. You can insert random red character here, but a lot of times it just happens to be a stormtrooper.
There's a lot of them.
And it's oftentimes the thing that's off the board first. And so let's say my stormtrooper has 6 damage on him.
Mm-hmm.
Has 1 damage left. I can do 3 to that stormtrooper and remove 2 of my opponent's dice. That trade is excellent. And of course, that's best case scenario trading.
Well, what's better than that is if you have a redeploy weapon on that bad boy.
Oh, can you even imagine?
If you've already gone.
Let's say your stormtrooper has a lightsaber and
or
a rifle.
Gun, or the rifle.
See, it has both.
And it's like,
it's a cool stormtrooper
I'll
on
move
Earth.
2 of your dice. I move attachments over so that I can reuse the dice.
And now I activate the character I just moved everything to. It can be really, really good. If you're just using it straight up, like uninjured stormtrooper, do 3, remove 2. Obviously, in the right scenario, it's the right play. But you have to, the thing is, it doesn't really matter at a certain point what the drawback is. You have to have cards to remove dice from your opponent's pool.
Yeah.
You can't let them run the game doing exactly what they want to do. Well, this game wants you to disrupt their plans.
And I think the exchange, right? Like, because at first it's like 3 damage, that's almost half a stormtrooper.
Yeah.
It's like, that can't ever
That's
work.
A good that, measure, too. I like measuring things in half stormtroopers.
That's right. 0.56
This is how you bake a vanilla Star Wars cake,
but
since we're doing
the
it.
The trick is, if you get to remove 2 dice of your choice, removing dice is very powerful. And typically, when that's happening, you should be removing at least 3 or more damage.
Oh, yeah.
And the difference is, I'm forcing you to put that damage on stormtrooper.
It's true.
Right?
It's true.
So I actually think this card is, just even without shields or without a character at 6 damage, down the line, remarkable.
And now you've made me think it's better than I thought it was.
That's right. Back and forth. Here we go.
So if we keep going, we're just going to run nothing but
eventually,
this card.
This is going to be the card that just every... I'm going to run 30 of those cards. You can't do that. 2 each. Anyways, I think that card's actually insanely better than I gave it credit
and
for.
It,
but that's what's so cool about a new game like this, is it's you're learning how to evaluate all this.
And you have to love the art and the just sentiment of the card.
Just look
here.
At that chat in the background.
Yeah, the best defense basically meaning put stormtroopers in front of it.
Yep.
Whatever it is.
That's how you
spaceship, laser fire, grenade, doesn't matter. Just put the white seats in front of it and see what happens.
And I mean, that's why Vader hangs around with them.
I guess so.
He lasts a long time, man.
I'm gonna kick it off, not kick it off, but continue with the last of the red cards. I think you've got the neutrals over there.
Oh, yeah.
This is a support / vehicle for the villains. It is red. It's 3 costs. It's the first order TIE fighter. Here we have an actual vehicle. So we see vehicles taking part in the game. Expensive.
Super cool.
Here we go, though. We've got, of course, the 6 sides. 1 range damage, 2 range damage, 3 range damage for a resource, 1 disrupt, which is a discard of a resource, and 1 special ability, followed by a blank, of course.
Thanks, Keith.
And then we have the special ability, remove all shields from all of an opponent's characters. It's just, see, this is what we're talking about. You have one card that Zach did earlier, Intimidate. Yep. Remove shields from a character, whatever. You have a die roll on the First Order TIE Fighter that can damage people, which is great, is what you want.
Or nuke all shields.
Or nuke all shields. Your opponent could have a max probably of like 9 shields on the board. Maybe 12.
Well, so I think you can run you can run 4 characters.
It
depends. I mean, it would be a weird...
It'd be very bizarre, but...
But I imagine at some point there will be like a swarmy deck, right? It's like, I have 2 Duskan Raiders and 2 Stormtroopers, and like, here we go.
The second that you, I mean, first turn, let's say you build to second turn, that you haven't done any damage, they've still got their 2 opening shields, they've shielded with some dice, they've got 4 or 5 on the board. This is amazing.
Yeah.
And I think this, roll it, boom.
It's just the kind of card, so it does something in and of itself, even without that special ability mattering.
Absolutely.
But in the event that there is a deck that is abusing shields, regenerating shields, they just keep putting shields out, you can't get damage through, this is just like a silver bullet.
It's an answer.
And so like, as opposed to Intimidate, that is literally only ever going to be a remove a shield from a single character, this does something in every game and then sometimes can just be a get out of jail free card.
And I say that even at the same time, I have a lot of trouble playing this card. Again, 3 costs and it just gives you 1 dice and that's it. All right, so you got the neutrals, right?
Yep.
You gonna start with AIM?
All right, first up, we have AIM. It's a neutral event, 1 cost. It is, says, turn 1 of your dice to a side showing range damage.
Okay, well, there's a lot to think about here, actually, right? You have a lot to think about? You don't like this as much. I don't like it as much either, but I will say this. There's a number of times when you just need to show actual damage because you've got a lot of +2, +1 on the board. And this is a way to guarantee that you can get that symbol, right?
Yeah. The problem I run into with this card is it's going to take, it takes a card and a resource to take an action to turn it to the side and then your opponent gets to go. Mm-hmm. And I think there are going to be a lot of decks that are controlling dice or at least sitting on controlling dice options. And so to spend my resource and actions here on a card that can only ever change a die to a range side.
Yes.
Obviously, it's only going to fit into decks that are running range damage. But... It's okay.
It's okay. Let's just leave it at that. Let's leave it okay. It aims.
In the right decks, it can be very important. There's so many cards that are like, change any die to any side you want.
Yeah.
It's like, well, you're going to run that before you run this.
It feels like the kind of card that you run maybe in the first cycle and then eventually just gets replaced because there's going to be better options.
Yeah. At first, it's acceptable, and then at some point, it's just not efficient enough.
And then sometimes you might find an Imperial Star Destroyer that has 6 range damage on a side.
And this card becomes what you need.
You might want to aim it.
Yeah, and I mean, even like a 3 range damage would probably be enough to like...
Make it worth it?
Start making you think about it.
But try it. Try it in the deck. See if you like it. It's great. Okay, now we're going on to a series of neutral cards that kind of have the same theme, beginning with Block. This is a remove all of an opponent's dice showing melee damage. Neutral card, 2 cost. Remove all dice showing melee. Here's what I would say, guys.
This is the one I really don't like.
I don't think this is worth having. Not at all.
I mean,
not at all.
2 costs is a lot to do this.
It's crazy.
You could potentially remove a lot of dice. But the thing is, when you start playing a lot, I rarely am in a position where I have a lot of the same dice showing.
Yeah.
Let alone a lot of dice active at the same time. Because you have these cards. I don't remember the name of it. There's a Jedi-style one that, like, split your die into 2 pools.
Oh, yeah. Oh, it's so good. It's so frustrating.
Yeah.
Literally, think about this. Let's say you've got 6 dice active. You just rolled your pools, and you're like, I'm so powerful. And then it's like, split your dice into 2 pools, and then your opponent gets to choose one that you keep, basically.
Yeah. So one of the pools. So because of those kind of cards, and even this, right, like a block, where it's like they can remove all of the same thing.
Yeah.
The more die you have showing on a thing, it gets suspect. So I think players will just naturally start playing around this.
Yes.
I could be totally wrong.
I
play around it naturally. So I know that like Steven had it in his deck, and he's just sitting on it.
Yeah.
And
it's worthless. Oh.
And 2 is so many.
At the max, maybe you remove 2, 3 dice?
2 needs to be like bringing the heat.
Yeah, yeah.
Because as an example, right, literally the same cost as Immobilize.
Yeah.
Which is a die that can do something else and also remove turn a die at will.
It's a hedge, though. We could at some point see like a huge rush deck that has a bunch of little guys with a ton of melee damage.
Yeah, and they're just waiting to do the thing. All right, next up we have Close Quarters Assault. It's a 0 cost event featuring the one and only Chewbacca. Neutral, count the number of dice you have showing melee damage. Discard that many random cards from an opponent's hand.
Now this is cool, because you're only counting the number. You don't have I used to think you had to discard the dice to
which
do this,
would be
but
bad.
No, you just count it.
That'd be so bad.
So let's say you have 2 to 3, which is the max you're probably gonna. Now there may be a Wookiee deck in the future. We haven't, you know, said that this isn't gonna happen.
So I like this card a lot.
It's way better. It's zero cost,
first
of all.
Zero cost, first off.
That's a good deal.
In a deck where you have lots of dice showing melee damage, maybe Force Users or Wookiees, if that ever exists, or whatever.
I guarantee you that will exist.
It will definitely exist. I can't wait, actually. Ewok deck.
I can wait on the Ewok deck.
A little like three cost Ewoks. Yeah, you can run 10 of these. Anyways, that'd be so funny. Gosh. I think you can very reasonably expect to be showing 1, 2, 3 cards, right?
Yeah.
And like zero cost, even discarding one at random.
It can be significant.
A ton of turns, your opponent's down to like 2 cards, right? There's the one they were saving to play and the other one they're saving to discard to reroll.
Yeah.
And being able to discard 1 or 2, like right in that moment, can just be, they're out of cards. Let alone if you get up to 3, maybe 4.
Let's not forget that this also is a win condition. Now, all these discard effects can turn into late game win conditions, so you hold 1 or 2 close quarters assault for the last few turns. All of a sudden,
man, you know, if you have 2 at the end,
you run your Vader like, deck. You have 2 to 3, and boom,
out of hand,
done.
Yeah, which I think this card's good.
Zach and I just got amped. For
yeah,
that
we
deck,
did.
Actually, we probably just clicked.
Just witnessed how cool that is.
All right, so that's good. Let's move on to something that's less exciting. 2-cost dodge. This is in the same category as block, as you might
block
expect.
And dodge.
Remove all of an opponent's dice showing range damage. Little blaster icon.
I'm gonna go ahead and just say. Copy and paste conversation from earlier. It's the same thing. If it had an ambush and was 1 cost, I would think about playing it.
I thought we were copy pasting. Now we've added.
Oh, sorry. Addendum. Paste. All paste right. The other conversation. Anyways,
next
up we have flank. Didn't we go over flank?
We haven't done flank. Right, close quarters assault, which looks kind of similar.
Yes, we have a Wookiee with a nice.
It looks so good. It looks so good. You guys can see it.
He's about to chomp. Look, he's about to just get that trooper. Anyways, 1-cost flank event. It's neutral. Play only if you have more ready characters than an opponent.
I love this card.
Remove one of that opponent's dice.
I love this card.
I think it's cool. It's a just straight up removal. Don't have to spot a certain kind of character. The one condition is I have to have more ready characters than you do, and there are going to be decks where this is great, and there's going to be decks that don't run it because they only have 2 characters.
It's a long play kind of a card. It really gives decks that want to build resources and play more of a long-term game an answer to early rush cards.
It's a really clever way to flank. It's like, you've got 1 character active left, and I have 2. I'm flanking you.
Just flank, yeah.
Like
that's how that goes.
That's cool. That's a really well done card.
All right, well, let's go to one of the final of the neutrals. Take cover. It's a 0-cost event. Give a character 1 shield. Okay. Zero cost, 1 shield.
I want to compare this for a second to the...
It's high impact enough.
Well, where are we at here? Like aim, right? The 1-cost, turn a die to a side. The trick of this card is that it always does something.
It does always do something.
It will always give you a shield. There's never a time where it won't, and it's free.
We can't deny that.
So, like, depends on your deck. There are decks that will abuse shields, and this will probably slot in.
I think ultimately this is one of those cards that will kind of fall by the wayside. It just isn't high impact enough. I think we're going to see a lot more high impact cards.
Well, especially once you get 2 or 3 sets in, you have a bunch of cards and that kind of a thing.
But they're also, let's not forget, there probably is going to be a lot of decks that trigger off of, if this character is shielded, do why?
Yeah.
Or, you know, if 100%. You have a shield here, then...
And honestly, a surprise shield, going to that last turn of the game, it's like, oh, you think you need 3 damage to win, you roll the 3, I get a shield, you don't win.
It can be serious.
It can be devastating. All right, my last card is Nowhere to Run. It's a villain card. It's 2 cost. The Dianoga there, Chewie, looks very sad. It's very,
he's
in that moment where he's against the door. Anyways, turn each of your dice showing a blank to any side.
Wait, what? For 2?
2 costs.
Huh.
Interesting. So
that seems great. So we have 2 to turn everything to what you want. We have 2 to remove everything of a certain kind.
2 to turn all of your blanks to a side of your choice.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. That makes more sense.
It's very powerful. And in the event you have 3 or 4 dice showing blanks, insane. But the reality is all those dice are 1 and 6. So unless you run Stormtroopers, which are 1 and 3, but, you know.
I mean, this is a 4 Stormtrooper deck, like, include, right? Yeah, because let me just imagine this. I mean, obviously 2 cost is hard, and you guys will hopefully agree with us whenever you bust out your own starter sets. But if I have 4 Stormtroopers in the imperfect or perfect world, let's say I've got a couple of Power of the Dark Sides, right? So I can actually reroll 2 blanks
to get
2 damage to then turn. But if I have four Stormtrooper dice and I happen to have four blanks on the table and I can turn them all to two range damage, that's eight damage. I mean, we can't deny
that's a real
eight
thing.
Damage.
And there's a, what's the red card, you take the two actions.
Yeah, it was so good. It's so good.
So there's a red card, you can basically
take the initiative or something.
Take two actions in a row. And like the idea that you could effectively play this card and then spend the dice, that's the other trick.
Yeah.
Is that a lot of these cards, you take an action and then your opponent goes.
Yeah.
So the cards like change to a range damage you want. They have a chance to like deny it. But this could literally just kill a character.
And it's also a great...
To be fair.
A lot of control cards turn your dice to blanks, so you then
so it's
can
a nice anti...
be controlled and then, yeah. Woo, surprise.
This card is interesting, but again, it's one of those, if it had ambush or was one cost, it would get a lot more interesting,
yeah.
But it's probably correctly designed to not be too good.
Yeah.
And here we are, right down the middle. It's down the middle.
Well, finally, we have Infantry Grenades. This is the neutral dice card. Two cost, and it comes with four sides that do something in two blanks. One damage ranged, two range damage for a resource, one resource, and a special ability. So it's gonna need to do something really significant here. It's an upgrade on a weapon. Special ability, deal three damage to each of an opponent's characters. Discard this upgrade from play. All right, so Zach.
Hit me with your best thoughts.
So, starter deck on starter deck, awful. Completely awful. You're looking at a couple characters on both sides of the board, not a big deal.
At best, you're going to do four damage. If they're shielded, you're not.
When you come into the tournament, after a couple weeks of playing, and the gals put together four Stormtroopers in a deck,
Troopers and two Tuskens.
Four Padawans, or a couple of Tuskens and some other.
If they have four characters out, this is crazy.
If your Ewok deck comes to fruition and they're all 5 cost, and you can run six of them or whatever it is. This gets a lot better, so this I feel like is a future card. This is a card to say, if we do some swarmier stuff, which I think they will.
Absolutely.
This is a kind of a way to deal with a lot of characters being on the board. But out of the gate, it's not very impressive.
Yeah.
It's just not.
Yeah, I mean, what it does when it's not, and you have to roll the special, right? And when it's not rolling the special, it's really, for two costs, I mean, there's so many upgrades that are two costs that I would rather have.
And it's weirdly a villain card. Which I didn't catch at first. I feel like an infantry grenade could probably be used by anybody, but villains only. Because apparently the usage of high impact grenades is just
it's
above the heroes.
For the antagonists.
Well, there you have it, guys. We're so happy to be here, to be honest with you. This is just a game that has totally revived a lot of my childhood, I guess, nostalgia. For what it was like to have so many unknowns and to be so involved in the Star Wars universe and to get to anticipate what's gonna happen when your favorite characters come into play. What are these new characters gonna look like, right? Who are we gonna get? And every set dropping like hundreds of cards and getting in the frenzy of unboxing everything and trying to figure out the
and
decks and everything changing all at once. So it's kind of a nice little change of pace from the LCG format where we have that consistent stream of content and now we're getting those bursts again. It's just kind of fun to be back in that zone.
Yeah,
both
it's very
of them
exciting.
Very have a lot of merit.
I think the more we played and the more it was just like, you think you have it figured out.
Yeah.
And then a different style of deck shows up because the deck building is so wide open.
It goes
like,
deep.
Incredibly wide open. And I'm just really excited to get all the cards.
Yeah.
So this has been a look at all the cards in the Kylo starter available from the get.
And check out our unboxing series that we're doing here. We've got some more videos planned. We've got some preview videos that are coming up. We also have a couple articles on our site, probably with more to come from us and from the community. And we have products on our store. So check those out with really some more to come. Which
a lot more to come.
You're not
so stay tuned.
Right?
Keep watching. Plenty of videos, plenty of products. We'll catch you guys in the next Destiny video.